The Enchiridion of Epictetus, written by Epictetus, narrated by Jack Nolan. The Enchiridion of Epictetus. Introduction. The little book by Epictetus called Enchiridion, or Manual, has played a disproportionately large role in the rise of modern attitudes and modern philosophy. As soon as it had been translated into the vernacular languages, it became a bestseller among independent intellectuals, among anti-Christian thinkers, and among philosophers of a subjective cast. Montaigne had a copy of the Enchiridion among his books. Pascal violently rejected the megalomaniac pride of the Stoic philosopher. Frederick the Great carried the book with him on all campaigns. It was a source of inspiration and encouragement to Anthony, Earl of Shaftesbury, in the serious illness which ended only in his death. Many pages of his diaries contain passages copied from the Enchiridion. It has been studied and widely quoted by Scottish philosophers like Francis Hutcheson, Adam Smith, and Adam Ferguson, who valued Stoic moral philosophy for its reconciliation of social dependency and personal independence. That there was a rebirth of Stoicism in the centuries of rebirth which marked the emergence of the modern age was not mere chance. Philosophical, moral, and social conditions of the time united to cause it. Roman Stoicism had been developed in times of despotism as a philosophy of lonely and courageous souls who had recognized the redeeming power of philosophical reason in all the moral and social purposes of life. Philosophy as a way of life makes men free. It is the last-ditch stand of liberty in a world of servitude. Many elements in the New Age led to thought which had structural affinity with Roman Stoicism. Modern times had created the independent thinker, the free intellectual, in a secular civilization. Modern times had destroyed medieval liberties and had established the new despotism of the absolute state, supported by ecclesiastical authority. Modern philosophies continued the basic trend in Stoicism in making the subjective consciousness the foundation of philosophy. The Stoic emphasis on moral problems was also appealing in an era of rapid transition, when all the values which had previously been taken for granted were questioned and reconsidered. While it is interesting to observe how varied were the effects produced by this small volume, this epitome of the Stoic system of moral philosophy, these effects seem still more remarkable when we consider that it was not intended to be a philosophical treatise on Stoicism for students. It was, rather, to be a guide for the advanced student of Stoicism, to show him the best roads toward the goal of becoming a true philosopher. Thus, Epictetus and his Enchiridion had a unique position in Roman Stoicism. Seneca and Marcus Aurelius had selected Stoic philosophy as the most adequate system for expressing their existential problems of independence, solitude, and history. In this enterprise, Seneca made tremendous strides toward the insights of social psychology as a byproduct of his consciousness of decadence. But he was not primarily concerned with the unity of the Stoic system. Marcus Aurelius changed the philosophical doctrine into the regimen of the lonesome ruler. In contrast to both, Epictetus was teaching Stoic philosophy as a doctrine and as a way of life. The Enchiridion is a summary of theoretical and applied Stoicism. Epictetus was the son of a woman slave, born between 50 and 60 AD at Hierapolis in Phrygia. We do not know how he came to Rome. He was there as slave to one of Nero's distinguished freedmen, who served as the emperor's secretary. While still in service, Epictetus took courses with Musonius Rufus, the fashionable Stoic philosopher, who was impressed by the sincere and dynamic personality of the young slave and trained him to be a Stoic philosopher. Epictetus became a free man and began teaching philosophy on street corners in the market, but he was not successful. During the rule of Domitian, Epictetus, with many other philosophers, was exiled from Rome, probably between 89 and 92 AD. He went to Nicopolis, across Actium, in Epirus, where he conducted his own school. He was so well regarded and highly esteemed that he established the reputation of the place as the town of Epictetus' school. Students came from Athens and Rome to attend his classes. Private citizens came to ask his advice and guidance. Some of his students returned to their homes to enter the traditional careers to which they were socially obligated. Others assumed the philosophic way of life in order to escape into the sphere of Stoic freedom. Among the students was a young Roman, Flavius Arrian, who took courses at Nicopolis when Epictetus was already old. Flavius, who was born in 108 AD, was one of the intimates of Hadrian, who made him consul in 130 AD. He probably studied with Epictetus between the years 123 and 126 AD. The informal philosophical talks which Epictetus had with his students fascinated him. Needless to say, there were also systematic courses in the fields of philosophy. But it was the informal discourses which convinced Arrian that he had finally discovered a Stoic Socrates, or a Stoic Diogenes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.